Gould fulfilled his dream of a secret existence, not only by withdrawing from the real world, but also by creating some 24 fictitious aliases that he used in his texts and in radio and TV shows.
Sir Norman Bullock
Was this
Carver.
Just an amusing game with pseudonyms
Stafford
designed
Byers.
To confuse? Or was it an
Myron
example
Chianti.
Of constructive frustration and an ego H. problem, B. as several psychoanalysts have claimed?
Duncan Haig Guinness. Professor Dr. Karl-Heinz Heinkel. Paul D. Hicks.
A person suffering from this ego problem
Dr. Herbert
can no longer
Hormeister.
Bear to stand alongside himself, as it were,
Marta
and observe himself with amazement.
David Johnson.
Or he is paralyzed by
Karl
the feeling
Klopfweiser.
That everything he does is meaningless.
Dr. Wolfgang from Kronkmeister.
The human organism keeps its grip on life at every moment
Waldorf Major.
By maintaining the boundary between itself
Carrie McQuay.
And the space outside itself,
Zoltan
while constantly
Mustany.
Trying to preserve its individuality.
Peggy Mulheim. Domenico Pastrano. Alain Pauvry. Sir Humphrey Price Davis. Homer Sibelius. Theodore Slutz. Sir Nigel Twitt Thornwaite. Jonathan Winan.
The most brilliant and also revealing of his games of hide-and-seek, of his various disguises, appeared in High Fidelity magazine in February 1974. Glenn Gould interviews Glenn Gould about Glenn Gould, Volume 1, Number 1 of the complete Gould-Gould Conversations, a text that would supply any psychiatrist with ample material for a case study.
Let's say, for example, that I had been privileged to reside in a town in which all the houses were painted
battleship gray.
So, why battleship gray?
It's my favorite color.
It's a rather negative color, ain't it?
That's why it's my favorite. Now then, let's suppose, for the sake of argument, that without warning, one individual elected to paint his house fire engine red.
Thereby challenging the symmetry of the
yes,
town planning.
Yes, it would probably do that too. But you're approaching the question from an aesthetic point of view. The real consequence of his action would be to foreshadow an outbreak of manic activity in the town. And, almost inevitably, since other houses would be painted in similar garish hues, to encourage a climate of competition and, as a corollary, of violence.
I gather then that red in your color lexicon represents aggressive behavior.
I should have thought there'd be general agreement on that. But, as I said, there would be an aesthetic moral overlap at this point. The man who painted the first house may have done so purely from an aesthetic preference. And it would, to use an old-fashioned word, be sinful if I were to take him to account in respect of his taste. But if I were able to persuade him that his particular aesthetic indulgence represented a moral danger to the community as a whole, that would, I think, be my responsibility.
You do realize, of course, that you're beginning to talk like a character out of Orwell.
Oh, the Orwellian world holds no particular terrors for me.
And you also realize that you're defining and defending a type of censorship that contradicts the whole post-Renaissance tradition of Western thought.
Certainly. It's the post-Renaissance tradition that has brought the Western world to the brink of destruction. You know, this odd attachment to freedom of movement, freedom of speech, and so on, is a peculiarly Occidental phenomenon.
Is there any other career of interest to you?
I've often thought that I'd like to try my hand at being a prisoner.
You regard that as a career?
Oh, certainly. On the understanding, of course, that I would be entirely innocent of all charges brought against me.
Mr. Gould, has anyone suggested to you that you could be suffering from a Mishkin complex?
No, and I can't accept the compliment. It's simply that, as I indicated, I never understood the preoccupation with freedom as it's reckoned in the Western world. I don't deserve the Michigan Complex title.
Well, your modesty is legendary, of course, Mr. Gould, but what brings you to that conviction?
The fact that I would inevitably impose demand upon my keepers. Demands that a genuinely free spirit could afford to overlook.
Such as?
The cell would have to be prepared in a battleship-grade, Igor.